of you to answer the question. In general, how would you rate your health? Excellent, very good, good, fair, or poor? So pick a category and then just spend a couple of seconds thinking about why you chose that category. And I'll come back to this. So believe it or not, that one single question is really important. And doctors don't like this very much. We could ask you that question, and I can predict for your healthcare utilization in the future, so how much you're going to use healthcare. And it's a good predictor of your death, your early death, if it's going to be an early death. Why? There's a whole variety of reasons for it. I'm going to start by explaining that why health is unequally distributed across society, and it's not quite as straightforward as you think. So what we have here is the horizontal axis is three measures of social position, someone's position in overall society, low, middle, and high. What you have on the vertical axis is health. Okay? There's a gap between the top and the bottom. So that is health inequalities, the gap in health between the top and bottom of the social hierarchy. And it is a social hierarchy. So what do I mean by health? Just about anything you can think of. Death, diabetes, depression, cancer, and surprisingly, your odds of dying from an accidental cause of death. There's a real gradient. It's not poverty versus everyone else. There's no magic threshold and cutoff. It exists regardless of the measure of social position, and it's maintained over time. And that gradient, because I call it a gradient, exists for both the risk factors and the health itself. And that social position can be measured almost any way you can think of and whatever fits the local society. Education, income, occupational prestige, number of bedrooms. It's really strange. And the social class measure fits the society you're in. So in the old Soviet Union, it was education. In modern Chinese teenagers, it's the family's affiliation with the central ruling party. In Australia and the United States, it's income. All right? Whatever it is, humans, wherever they are, and no matter what the culture is, there is a social hierarchy with some kind of a measure of social position. The steepness of that gradient varies from society to society. And in some societies, it's much less steep than in others. And one of the fundamental problems is that the steeper that social gradient, the less healthy everyone is, including the well-to-do. So that's the hard measures, or the ones that scientists like to use, or the things we can take off the census. But if I ask you to place yourself on this ladder and tell you that on this ladder, the people at the top are on rung 10 and the people at the bottom in your local community, your society, your country are at the bottom, you pick a rung, and that rung is absolutely brilliant, plus the other information about education and income, etc., in telling me, in providing a relationship with your health. The lower you feel about your position in society, because that's what this ladder is, the worse your health is going to be, the shorter your life expectancy is going to be, and the sicker you're going to be when you finally get ill, because everyone will get ill eventually. So this social position, your relative position in society, is cumulative. It starts in childhood and it goes all the way through, and the effects are long-term. They accumulate throughout your life. This is why we have the Labour Party here saying that they want to have an increase in the Sure Start program, because we know that helping kids in the early years has a long-term impact on the economy and people's health, and of course, the costs. But health has improved for everyone over the past century, and this graphic shows that what's happening. So essentially, the red line is, say, the middle of, or the beginning of the 20th century. The blue line is today. Everyone's health has improved. But if everyone's health improves at the same time, the gap doesn't actually change. If everyone gets better at the same rate, it doesn't change. But of course, what we want to happen is for the slope of the line to change. We want the most disadvantaged in society, the people who are the most affected, to have the greatest health improvement. And it's difficult to do that because people keep to the behaviors they pay.
the behaviors that are in their social group. The way you behave is related to where you fall in the social hierarchy, the things you expect to do. So there's been lots of explanations about this gradient. It's been documented for a long time and documented formally in statistics since at least the 1950s. One of them is, well, there's way more poor people than there is rich people. That's true. But we do deaths or cancer or whatever per 100,000 rich people and per 100,000 poor people. So we're already dividing by the number of people there are. We talk about differential access to healthcare. In many places in the world, that is still true, but as I'll show you in a few minutes, it doesn't really explain much of the difference. And certainly in countries like Canada and the United Kingdom, where healthcare is universally available, it's not a good explanation. We talk about social mobility. So people who are healthy rise farther and do better in life, and people who are ill fall down the social thing. That's true, okay? It is true. It's just not happening at a great proportion of the population. Basically, over the past, especially 30 or 40 years, everyone's health has improved, not just a few people here and there. People always want to offer the genetics explanation. At best, it probably explains 10%, because there's just not a gene for that. One of the explanations that is true is material well-being. And one of the ways to think about that is the overall wealth of the entire population. So the whole country that you live in, the economy that you live within. And there's been some work done by a group in Sweden called Gapminder. You can all just look this up on the web. And they have created a graphic that you can go out and run. Hans is on one of the TED Talks, standing behind this fantastic graphic interface he's got, explaining all of this. And what you have on the horizontal axis is basically the income of a country divided by all the people that are in it, standardized to American dollars, right? And it just goes up, as you can see, in $10,000 increments. On the vertical axis, you have life expectancy. Each of those circles represents a different country. The color tells you what region it's in, and the size tells you what proportion of the world's population it has. The big red dots are China and India. And this is 1900. By 1950, which is the first time this graphic was actually produced, it's called the Preston curve, the line goes up in 1950 with a lift of the tip, and then after that, it levels off. So above about $10,000 per person, there's no added benefit to life expectancy from the overall wealth of an economy. None at all. It's just not there. So there's something else affecting things. There's something else going on. There's something, in my opinion, that about the way a society is organized. So one of the arguments that's made all the time is poor people behave badly. So they engage in anti-health behaviors. They smoke, they drink. It's true. The farther you go down the social hierarchy, the more people are engaged in health, anti-health behaviors. But it's not the whole explanation. There's no rule that says poor people have to behave badly. So why do people? Another explanation that's given is psychosocial. So this is usually interpreted as, well, it's really stressful being poor. It's true. It is stressful being poor. But how come there's a difference between people who are just above those at the top and people at the top? It's not that particularly stressful, having a good income and all the resources you need and all that kind of challenges, compared to the person who's 10,000 pounds a year greater in income than you are. So why is it a gradient? It goes all the way up. And I'm arguing that it's, so people talk about the stress of living at the bottom. Well, yeah, it goes up to a point. But I'm arguing that part of the difference is that we know what we're supposed to do. Everyone in the population can say, give me five things that you should do so that your health would be better. And everybody can rhyme off five. Most people can rhyme off seven or more. We've absorbed all the messages, okay? But people behave like everyone else around them. And we've heard this already today, haven't we? We've heard this twice, okay? Already this morning. People behave like everyone else around them. And we shouldn't belittle them for doing that. That's what makes living in society tolerable, okay? It makes it less stressful. It makes it comfortable for everybody. But we're acutely sensitive, and we're designed to be acutely sensitive to the way other people around us behave. So what do we do on a Friday night? We sit in the pub
if we don't drink, is there something wrong with that person? You're all right, George. You're not drinking tonight. You want to go for a run. There's no pavement. There's no nearby park. And, ooh, I might get mugged. Or, worse yet, my labor's going,
look at him. He's running.
Right? You know, it matters. It matters to make our life tolerable. We have to worry about how other people see us. But the thing is, we need to reduce the gap. Because one of the things everybody needs to understand is the steeper that gradient, the less healthy everyone is, even the rich. Right? Sorry, if there's a really steep gradient, everyone's health is affected. And we don't understand why. We really don't understand why. So what do we do? Well, part of it is we have to do whole systems approaches. We have to think about the health in all things. So there's this public health way of approaching things where you talk about health when you're planning transportation systems, when you're looking at air pollution, when you're designing some new building. You talk about health in all aspects. You think about that. You think you work from the top down and the bottom up at exactly the same time. Because you can't put a policy in place, because the Canadian government's already tried this, without having buy-in from the general public. You have to do both things. You have to make people understand the gradient. It's not a magic cutoff. It's not poverty. It's because poverty cutoffs mean it's us and them. It has to be us. It has to be everybody has to recognize that this matters, and it makes a big difference, and it matters to the economy. If you get ill and you're in your 40s, you're not paying taxes, and you're costing the system money in benefits and healthcare costs, well, outside the United States. So you have to recognize that it has this impact, right? So one example I can give you, this thinking is starting, and you certainly see this thinking in the WHO Europe, and that kind of thing. But we've got something here in Sheffield that we've just got funded, central government funded, Advanced Wellbeing Research Center. And they are deliberately bringing themselves into a new perspective, right? We're changing from individual behavior approach, the individual shaming and blaming, to how do we get the whole community engaged? How do we bring the community into the project right from the beginning and make them feel that they own part of it, they are part of it, and they change their behaviors as a result. We've got to change society, not just individuals one at a time. Thank you.